Welcome back, everyone. I'm Jordan Giesige, and this is The Limiting Factor. Tesla's filed a patent for high-voltage electrolytes, and they're testing those electrolytes on high manganese lithium-ion battery cells with some of the best battery labs in the world. Why would they do that, and what's the significance? At Battery Day, Tesla showed plans to produce 4680 battery cells that use a cathode that's likely around 60% nickel and 40% manganese. That's as compared to the current version of the 4680, which has a high nickel cathode that uses 91% nickel, 5% cobalt, and only 4% manganese. A high manganese battery would eliminate one-third of the costly nickel and all of the cobalt, and replace it with manganese that costs about 90% less per ton. By my estimate, that would reduce the cost of a 4680 battery pack in a Model 3 or Y by about $1,000. However, based on current expectations, those high manganese battery cells would have around 15% lower energy density, meaning they would take up about 15% more space or 15% more mass for the same energy capacity. In other words, Tesla couldn't just swap out the high nickel cathode in their batteries for a high manganese one that was slightly cheaper. There would be compromises in vehicle energy efficiency and/or range. But if Tesla was able to increase the energy density of high manganese battery cells by increasing their voltage with a new electrolyte formulation, it could kill two birds with one stone. They could swap in the high-voltage, high-manganese battery cells and reduce the cost of the battery pack by about $1,000 while having minimal impact on range. As is always the case with batteries, there is more to the story, and today I'll walk you through the details. Before we begin, a special thanks to my Patreon supporters, YouTube members, and Twitter subscribers, as well as Rebellionaire.com. They specialize in helping investors manage concentrated positions. Rebellionaire can help with covered calls, risk management, and creating a money master plan from your financial first principles. Let's start off with how I discovered Tesla's potential ambitions with high-voltage, high-manganese lithium-ion battery cells. In August of last year, SETI Park on X shared a patent application from Tesla titled Electrolyte Additive Compounds for High-Voltage Energy Storage Device and Associated Processes. I put the patent on the bottom of my priority stack because although higher voltages increase the energy density of lithium-ion batteries, it wasn't a persuasive technology pathway. Increasing the voltage dramatically increases unwanted chemical reactions within the cell, particularly with the electrolyte, causing degradation which reduces cycle life. More robust, high-voltage electrolytes can reduce that degradation and improve cycle life, but from what I've seen in the past, they haven't done enough to resolve the trade-offs between cycle life and energy density. It's far easier to increase the energy density of battery cells by, for example, thinning out the cell can to decrease inactive material, increasing the thickness of the electrodes to add more active material, or adding silicon to the anode. Those solutions have drawbacks as well, but they have a better cost-benefit ratio than changing the electrolyte and increasing the voltage of the battery cell. Last week, I decided to review the patent application just in case there was something I was missing. The patent application itself was pretty much what I expected. It provided new electrolyte options for high-voltage batteries, along with lots of cycling data, and it made no additional case for why Tesla would actually want to adopt a high-voltage electrolyte over other potential options like silicon. Next, I checked the LinkedIn profiles of the listed inventors. That's where things got interesting. First, I noted that there was some serious laboratory firepower that went into the invention. It was a collaboration between chemists at Tesla, Jeff Don Research Group, and Argonne National Laboratory. Even Jeff Don himself, who's a legend in the battery industry, was listed as an inventor. Second, after reviewing the LinkedIn profiles of each of the inventors, I found that Saad Azam had posted a research paper on high-voltage electrolytes that included the other inventors listed on the patent application. That piqued my interest because, unlike patents, research papers typically include deeper insights and context that help justify why a technology might be useful. So I scoured the research paper for hints as to why high-voltage electrolytes might be more persuasive than I had previously assumed. The first thing that struck me about the research paper was that it focused on testing NMC640 cells for their long-term cycling tests, which is right in line with the high manganese chemistry that Tesla suggested at Battery Day. That left me scratching my head until I found the following sentences. First, quote, "The energy density of a cell containing cobalt-free NMC640 is the lowest in figure S1. But converges with that of a cell containing NMC532 when both are charged to 4.4 volts, and is comparable to the energy density of a cell containing NMC811 that is charged to 4.2 volts, end quote. Figure S1 was tucked away in a separate supplemental document to the research paper, and is shown on screen. It shows that at the typical maximum voltage of a lithium-ion battery, around 4.2 volts, a high manganese NMC640 chemistry stack has an energy density disadvantage of about 15% versus a high nickel NMC811 chemistry stack. By stack, they're simply referring to the cell parameters laid out in the lower right-hand corner of the graph. If the voltage of the high manganese cell stack is increased to 4.4 volts, it not only matches, but slightly exceeds the energy density of the NMC811 cell stack. Why is that? I asked Battery Bulletin on X, and he advised that the total energy storage capacity of high nickel and high manganese cathodes is similar. However, high manganese cathodes require higher voltages to react and extract lithium from their crystal structure. The ability to extract that lithium and move it around the battery cell is what allows the cell to store and release energy. So, in short, higher voltages mean greater access to lithium, which means higher energy densities, and the effect is particularly strong with high manganese cathodes because they react at higher voltages. The second sentence that caught my attention was, quote, "Of the materials considered, NMC811 shows the highest energy density at any given charge endpoint voltage. Data is not shown past 4.2 volts for this material because usage at higher voltage yields poor lifetime and diminishing energy density returns when compared to other materials, and is not typically done in a commercial setting," end quote. This explains why the graph stops at 4.2 volts for the high nickel NMC811 cathode. The researchers left higher voltages off the graph for NMC811 because, just as I had assumed in the past, NMC811 shows little energy capacity gain past 4.2 volts and significantly more degradation. That's as opposed to using high manganese cathodes at higher voltages, which the paper implies are worthwhile. Lastly, looking at the paper more broadly, I thought it was noteworthy how comprehensive the research paper was. It investigated a number of degradation mechanisms and indicators for dozens of electrolytes across first, second, and third generation electrolytes. First generation refers to high-voltage electrolytes studied in past research by the Don Research Group. Second generation refers to electrolytes that have recently garnered attention in academic and industrial research. And third generation refers to electrolytes that were invented for this research paper and described in Tesla's patent application. The fact that the research paper was so comprehensive and involved some of the best labs and battery researchers in the world indicates that Tesla, who funded the research, was putting a serious and concerted effort into finding the best high-voltage electrolyte for high manganese cells, which is presumably for the purpose of pushing towards commercialization. With that in mind, let's briefly explore the results of the research paper. What the researchers found was that at high voltages, specifically their target of 4.4 volts, the best performing electrolyte varied greatly depending on the temperature, ranging from 2,500 cycles at 20 degrees Celsius to 550 cycles at 55 degrees Celsius. And, as you can see on screen, the performance gaps between the top performing electrolytes for each temperature was, for the most part, relatively small. And the generation of the electrolyte, indicated by green, blue, and orange, didn't seem to correlate with performance. Great performing electrolytes came from each generation. The implication here is that we don't need to get into specifics about which electrolyte or electrolyte generation is the best. The takeaway is that if a company like Tesla wants to increase the voltage of their batteries, depending on the temperature requirements, there are a range of high voltage electrolytes available that could be commercially viable. I say that because a typical nickel-based battery in an EV usually lasts about 1,000 to 1,500 cycles at an average temperature of around 20 degrees Celsius. And this research paper showed that high-voltage electrolytes could hit 1,250 to 2,500 cycles at 20 to 40 degrees Celsius, with around a dozen electrolytes meeting at least 1,000 cycles. If you're wondering, cost wouldn't likely be an issue for commercializing these electrolytes because the researchers emphasized cost reductions throughout the paper and removed an electrolyte candidate in part due to its high cost. Lastly, it's worth noting that even slightly decreasing the voltage by 0.1 volt generally led to a doubling of cycle life. So if Tesla did use these high-voltage electrolytes and ran into cycle life issues, they could slightly decrease the voltage to provide a large increase in cycle life. The next question is, based on all this information, is Tesla preparing to commercialize high-voltage, high-manganese battery cells? In my view, that is their intent. If they can save $1,000 per vehicle with no range penalty or cycle life penalty, it would be what I'd consider a technology breakthrough. However, even if I'm correct and Tesla intends to deploy the technology, it would be at least a couple of years away before those cells enter mass production. That's for three reasons. First, I don't think they'll share this technology with their cell partners like Panasonic, meaning the chemistry would only be used in the 4680. And, at least at the time of this video, they still have to master and ramp the dry electrode coating process at Giga Texas for the 4680. It's unlikely they'll implement such a new chemistry until that's solved. Second, on that note, because high voltage, high manganese is a new technology, they'll be cautious about deployment. Due to that, my guess is that Tesla would introduce an NMC640 cell with a conventional voltage window first, and then could slowly increase the voltage over time to manage cycle life risks. Interestingly, they could actually include the high voltage electrolyte from the start, and the voltage window update could simply be done through a software update. Third, there may be a sequencing issue. The energy density of a high manganese cell can also be increased by adding silicon to the anode. Is it better to implement silicon first or the high voltage electrolyte? And how compatible are those two technologies? If they are compatible, Tesla could eventually stop production of their high nickel cells for mass sensitive applications and use high voltage, high manganese, silicon doped battery cells for all their vehicles instead. Such a high-performance cell would be at least 3 to 5 years away because of all the testing and development that would be required. But it is possible. As a final note, some people might be wondering about the compatibility of high-voltage electrolytes with LFP. My educated guess would be that it wouldn't be a technology pathway worth pursuing. That's because most of the lithium in an LFP battery cell is accessible at low voltage due to its flat and low voltage profile, meaning there would be little benefit in increasing the voltage. In summary, high voltage electrolytes offer a better cost-benefit ratio than I'd previously assumed, because I didn't factor in the unique benefits of pairing them with high manganese cathodes. So the technology appears to add to Tesla's impressive portfolio of potential energy density, cost, and charging speed improvements that I've covered in other videos, such as lithium doping, asymmetric lamination, carbon nanotubes, and silicon doping. Like you, I'm just waiting for them to start deploying those technologies in their 4680 battery cells. Tesla's head of 4680, Bonnie Eggleston, has teased new products are coming, but I don't expect much word on that this year. That's because currently, the primary focus of Tesla investors is the rollout of Robotaxi, and so I expect that's going to dominate the questions in upcoming earnings calls. But with new products like the Cybercab coming online next year, I'm hopeful we'll get more updates on the batteries going into those products. Either way, as always, I'll keep you updated quarterly and do deep dives when new information comes to light. If you enjoyed this video, please consider supporting the channel by using the links in the description. Also, consider following me on X. I often use X as a testbed for sharing ideas, and X subscribers, like my Patreon supporters, generally get access to my videos a week early. On that note, a special thanks to Hitesh, my YouTube members, X subscribers, and all the other patrons listed in the credits. I appreciate all of your support, and thanks for tuning in.